Humans have been telling stories from the very beginning. Stories that help us learn, help us feel, that make us laugh or cry, that inspire us, scare us, entertain us, and convict us. But there is one story that rises above the rest, because this story has been unfolding since the beginning of time. Because we are all a part of this story. Because this story is true. This is a story of hope, redemption, victory. This is a story of love, mercy, compassion. This is the true story of a God who loves his creation and his son who saves it. This is the greatest story ever.
Stories have been core to human existence from the very beginning. Stories that were told from parent to child and family to family and storyteller to community. For a long time in history, storytelling was primarily vocally, orally. Somebody would be a storyteller in a village or for a group of people, or parents would pass on stories from generation to generation. And then the printing press came along, and you had written words, so you have all kinds of books that are written. I grew up in a reading family. My parents, when I was a little kid, I still remember my parents had this giant blue book of children's stories. I think one of my sisters has inherited it and taken it. I got to find out where that is. But it was probably this thick, this big by this big on a light blue cover, and it had a collection of children's stories from all over the world. And my parents would read those when we were kids. And then we got a little bit older, and my parents, as a young child, turned me on to Edgar Rice Burroughs when I was like 9 or 10 or 11 years old and started reading a bunch of Burroughs. And then my dad was into science fiction, so I got reading Heinlein and Bradbury and different authors. And then I actually, when I was on my sabbatical, I found a John Grisham novel I hadn't read called The Testament. If you don't know this, John Grisham is actually a Sunday school teacher at his church. Really loves Jesus, and in that particular one, The Testament, that was one of the ones that didn't get made into a movie, I think, but most of the other ones, a lot of other ones did, but that one's got a lot more Jesus stuff in it, so it probably doesn't translate for most people to movies as well. But for a long time, storytelling came in books, and now I've got a stack of different movies here, all kinds of movies, and a lot of people today, they kind of hear their stories through video, through movie, through visuals and sound, but we're kind of compelled within us to love stories. But there was a story I had never heard till I was 16 years old. There was a story I had never heard. And then at 16 years old, someone gave me a Bible. I grew up in a story-based family, a reading family, but nobody in my family really read the Bible. And we weren't a Christian family. And someone gave me a Bible, and I got introduced to the greatest story ever. Because this story is utterly true, staggeringly beautiful, mysterious, at times hard to understand because it's in a certain time and history and context. But when you get a hold of this book and you start to read it, and when God begins to speak to you through his story, it's transformational. It's powerful. I know many of you, you got a copy of it. I think 1,000 people or so get a copy of the books of the Bible. All this is the New Testament. So that last portion of the Bible, the New Testament, without the chapters and verses, because in the original New Testament there weren't chapters and verses. Those were added later to be able to find things and study the Bible more. And then the books of the New Testament put in an order that's kind of a logical reading order. How many of you who are working on reading this are finding that the reading takes a little longer than you thought it might? Anybody? Okay, thank you. You're being honest. I did. I started doing the reading. I'm like, God, it's a lot of reading for each day. I'm actually not doing it in 5 days. I'm doing it in all 7 days. I'm kind of spreading it out over the 7 days. I'm just finding it easier to read that way. And so if you started with the reading this last Monday, and if you stuck with it, you've read the Gospel of Luke, one of the books of the New Testament. If you didn't start yet and you want to get a copy of this and you want to start with us, I would challenge you to do it one of two ways. Either start on week one, day one, which is Luke, and you'll hear a sermon today that is about Luke, and then you'll do the reading after the sermon. If you started last week, you're doing the reading before the sermon. But you can start tomorrow or today, and then do week one, and then just kind of always follow after the sermon. Or you can read a lot from last week and get caught up if you want to. And also, it's kind of neat, the bookmark, I'm using the bookmark to kind of guide my reading, but also to look at the questions that are on the back of the bookmark each day as I'm reading. But with the bookmark, there's a website you can go to, and it'll actually, you can download all the readings on audio files for your phone or your iPad, and then you could actually listen. If you're not really big on sitting for a long time and reading, you can listen to the whole story of the New Testament over the next 8 weeks when you're driving, when you're in your car. And so that may be more, you know, more appealing to some of you. The main thing is, and remember, if you're listening and not reading it out of this book, but you're listening, you're not cheating. You just say to yourself, I have an ancient approach to storytelling. See, they used to do it orally. They used to listen, right? So you say, I'm just an ancient learner. That's why, don't say I'm not a reader. You say I'm an ancient learner. Doesn't that sound so much cooler? Yeah, I'm an ancient learner. I like that. I'm going to write that down. But the idea that stories are so powerful, and the story of Jesus is the most powerful story in the history of the world. That's what we're going to think about today. And as we walk through the New Testament, as we walk through God's word, we're going to do something kind of different. We're going to look at it from three distinct vantage points or three kind of perspectives. And so when whoever's preaching, I'm doing six of the sermons, but there'll be other pastors preaching, two of them here in Monterey, and there's different pastors preaching in Pacific Grove and Iglesias Shoreline. But when we preach from up here, we're really looking at the story from the Father. God, we believe in one God, one eternal being who exists eternally in three persons, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And so God the Father is really, God the Father is the master storyteller. God the Father is the one who's telling the story of Jesus and writing the stories of our lives. And you'll see anywhere in the Bible, you'll see God the Father from his heavenly perspective kind of telling the story and creating the story and working in our lives. We don't believe in a God. We do not believe in a God who kind of made the earth, kind of set it on its axis and spun it, boom, and said, okay, have a nice eternity. I'm out of here. I'm done. We don't believe in a God that says, I have nothing to do with you. We believe in a God who's intimate and involved. He's the master storyteller. He's engaged in our lives. And so we'll look at the story through the heart of the Father. We'll look at what we see in Scripture through the heart of the Father. That's one perspective. So when we're up here, we're kind of looking from the Father's perspective. Down here on the main stage, we'll look through the eyes of Jesus. Because Jesus really is the center of the story. Jesus is the center of God's eternal story that God is telling. His life and his love, the life and the love of the Son of God, is the center of the story. So we'll look at the story through what Jesus did and how he worked it. And in every page of the Bible, in some way, you can find God at work through his Son, Jesus. Even before Jesus entered human history, he's being prophesied. And people are preparing for the coming of the Messiah, Jesus Christ, the Son of God. So we'll look at the story through the perspective of God the Father as the master storyteller. We'll look at the story through the eyes and the perspective of Jesus, who's the center of the story. And if we walk with him, he becomes the center of our story. But it doesn't end there. We'll also spend time each week thinking about the work of the Holy Spirit. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is still telling the story. The Holy Spirit is telling the story in your life and through your life. And some people have the sense that when Jesus died and rose again, the story kind of ended. No way. That's the starting of the story. And the Bible actually teaches us that when a person puts their faith in Jesus, Jesus, by his Holy Spirit, moves into them. Biblically, theologically, we believe if you're here and you've come to the cross and you've confessed your sins and you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior, we believe that the very Spirit of the living God moved into you. Now, that should freak you out a little bit. Don't take that lightly. God Almighty, by his Spirit, dwells in you and in me if you're a Christian. That's amazing. That's staggering. And he's still telling his story. And if you're here and you're not yet a Christian, the moment that you would come to the cross and receive Jesus, God Almighty is going to move inside of you. Really? Really. And so God is telling his story and writing his story. And the story of Jesus is still spreading around the world. And here's the interesting thing. It all began, storytelling began orally. But even to this day, when you're a follower of Jesus, you're called to tell your story, to talk about Jesus. That before Jesus left this planet, one of the most important things he said is, you now go and tell your story. You will be my witnesses. You'll tell your story right where you are, surrounding neighborhood, the tough places, to the ends of the earth. You're going to become my storytellers. That's why this Wednesday and Saturday, we're doing this two-hour training. Same training both days. Don't go to both. Just pick one of them. Same training both days. But we're going to teach you how to tell your story, the story that the Holy Spirit is writing in your heart through Jesus. And because as you tell your story to other people, they see that God's still alive, that Jesus is still at work. It's a beautiful thing. So I really want to encourage you as your pastor to do all you can to be here Wednesday night or next Sunday for that time of being equipped to tell your story. If you have one person in your life who doesn't know Jesus, who you love and care about, and you want in some way to share God's love with them, learn to tell your story. And that's what the whole training is going to be about, telling your story. I want to pray now and ask that over these 8 weeks, we will encounter our God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Telling the story, Jesus being the story, and the Spirit writing the story through your life. Let's pray together. Lord God, as we enter this 8 weeks together, with big chunks of reading over 5 days or 7 days of each week, I pray, Lord, that we'll be immersed in your scriptures. We'll encounter your Holy Spirit. We'll learn from you. And that we will see, oh God, that you're still alive, telling your story, writing your story, moving in great ways. Oh God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, teach us and work in our lives. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, let's begin where the story always begins. Let's begin in heaven with God the Father, who exists eternally. And I want you to notice in the story of Jesus, how God the Father is at work, how God the Father is moving. And so what I'm going to do is we're going to walk through some passages that look at what happened when Jesus, as Jesus is coming to this planet, but how the Father is telling the story, how the Father is guiding and directing the process. So if you have your Bible, you can open your Bible to the Gospel of Luke. If you have your books of the Bible, turn to page 3 in books of the Bible. And if you like to just kind of listen, it'll be up on the screen as well. So you can follow the books of the Bible. I'll give you the reference there. I'll give you the biblical reference if you want to follow the chapter and verses, and it'll be on the screen as well. I want you to first see the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit at work in the coming of Jesus and the work of Jesus. And we can see this in John the Baptist. John the Baptist has been conceived in his mother's womb, and God is speaking to Zechariah, who's John the Baptist's father, telling him what's going to happen and how God's going to work through his son. So Zechariah's a priest. He's gone to work for the day to the temple. And this is what happens. And so this is in Luke 1, beginning in verse 11, or the bottom of page 3, or on the screen. So Zechariah is at work. He's doing his priestly duties. Then an angel of the Lord appeared to him, to Zechariah, standing at the front side of the altar of incense. When Zechariah saw him, he was startled and was gripped with fear. Hit the pause button there. If you've ever met an angel, you'd know the feeling. If you haven't, you wouldn't know. But angels are heavenly beings who carry heavenly glory. This is my own theory, but first day of angel training class goes like this. Okay, when you meet a human, they're going to be terrified. So you always say something like, fear not, be not afraid. It's going to be okay because the whoever you meet is going to freak out, okay? And if you read through the Bible, when angels encountered humans, they're always like, hey, don't be afraid, because they're like, wah, angel, right? When Zechariah saw him, he was startled and was gripped with fear, but the angel said to him, do not be afraid. See, I told you right there. Do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard, and your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son. And you are to call him John. This is John the Baptist. He will be a joy and delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth. Now, I want you to notice the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit in this account. All right? He will be a joy and delight for you, and many will rejoice in his birth, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord. That's Yahweh. That's God Almighty. That's the Father. He'll be great in the sight of the Lord. He is never to take wine or fermented drink. He was going to be a Nazarite, and so they weren't allowed to. That was part of their vows. And he will be filled with the Holy Spirit. Okay, now the Holy Spirit is at work. So we see he'll bring pleasure to God the Father. He'll be filled with the Holy Spirit. Listen to this. Even before he is born. He says, John the Baptist will be filled with the Spirit even before he's born. It's a beautiful picture of a human being in a mother's womb filled with the Holy Spirit. Speaks the beauty and the power of life, even from the beginning. He'll be filled with the Holy Spirit even before he is born. He will bring back many of the people to Israel to the Lord their God. That's Yahweh. And he will go before the Lord. That's actually the Lord Jesus. He will go before. He's the one who prepared the way for the coming of Jesus. He was the messenger who said, prepare for the coming of the Lord. So he'll go before the Lord. In the spirit and the power of Elijah, to turn the hearts of the parents to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. You see, just in that little account of John the Baptist, you see God the Father, you see God the Son, and you see God the Holy Spirit working together in writing the story in Zechariah's life, in John the Baptist's life. And it's also true in your life and in my life. That's how God works. And so we kind of continue on through the beginning of Luke's gospel. Look at Luke 1:19, top of page 4. The angel said to him, "I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God." That's Yahweh. "I stand in the presence of the Father. And I have been sent to speak to you and to tell you this good news." Gabriel says, "I dwell and I live in the presence of Yahweh, God the Father." Now, Gabriel speaks to Mary. And I want you to notice that when people realize what's going on, they give praise to God the Father. They look up at God the Father and say, "God, you're at work. You're orchestrating this. You're glorified. You're doing something here." So in Luke 1:26 to 27, kind of the middle of page 4, God said to the angel Gabriel, sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." The Lord God, Yahweh, God the Father is with you. God is going to come and overshadow her and place within her this life that would enter humanity, this divine human hybrid that had never been thought of or heard of before. But God would come among us. It's amazing. And then we continue on. Mary gets a sense of what's going on, and she responds, giving glory to God the Father, to Yahweh. In Luke 1:46 and following, this is the top of page 5, Mary said, "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior." She's been told about the coming of Jesus, who she would bear, but she's now giving glory to the Creator, to the storyteller, to God the Father. "For he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant," Mary says. "And from now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name." She understands that what's happening to her, what's going to happen in history, is the work of God the Father, and she celebrates that. We continue on in this amazing story. In Luke 1:68, top of page 6, now Zechariah declares praise to the Father and God's great plan. Zechariah says, "Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, because he has come to his people and redeemed them. He has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David." He celebrates what God the Father is doing. Then the heavenly hosts join in. The angels of heaven acknowledge that God the Father is at work telling the story, preparing the way for the coming of Jesus. So now Jesus has been born. He's entered human history humbly in a manger. But the angels of heaven declare this. And this is found in Luke 2:14, middle of page 7. The angels praise God, saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." Glory to God the Father. His peace rests upon his people. God is at work. God is telling the story. God is preparing the way for Emmanuel, Jesus, the Messiah, to enter human history. But when all those people hear about it, they know who's telling the story. Praise and glory to God the Father. So even Simeon, this elderly man who loves God, who's been waiting for the coming of Messiah, Simeon's in the temple area when Mary and Joseph come in with Jesus. And Simeon sees them and he realizes, this is the one. This is the Jesus who's come. So Simeon sees Jesus with Mary and Joseph, and Simeon comes over and takes Jesus, God in human flesh, in his arms. It's a beautiful picture. His heart has been longing and waiting. He's been praying for the salvation of his people, the salvation of God to enter human history, and he realizes that God the Father is telling his story, and he holds in his arms the only one of heaven, Jesus Christ. And listen to his prayer. This is in Luke 2:29, top of page 8. "Sovereign Lord," he points to God the Father, "Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you may now dismiss your servant in peace." He's saying, "I could die right now. I could die happy. I'm holding in my arms the Savior of the world. He's come. The Messiah has come. For my eyes have seen your salvation." You can see him looking down at Jesus. "My eyes have seen your salvation." Here he is. "Which you have prepared in the sight of all nations, a light for revelation to the Gentiles, and the glory of your people Israel." Simeon just celebrates and is amazed. He holds in his arms Jesus, the Messiah. He's been praying and longing for the Messiah to come, and he realizes this is the one, and he celebrates it. God the Father is the great storyteller. And all through the Bible, you see God the Father leading and guiding and directing and orchestrating and loving and caring and moving in power. But now, God has invaded human history and Jesus has come. God the Son is here. He's the center of the story. And if you're reading the Gospel of Luke, if you read it this last week or if you read it this coming week, you're going to see that this Jesus who comes, he comes in power. Was anybody here struck if you read the Gospel of Luke this last week? And if you read it in 5 or 6 days, you get the whole thing in a big sweep. Was anybody struck how hardcore and tough Jesus could be? Was anybody struck by that? You're like, bring it, Jesus. Come on, bring it. It's like, you know, any sense of Jesus being this weak kind of, oh, I don't know, I'm not really sure where I stand on that. You know, let me just check the wind and see whatever. No, Jesus knew. I mean, Jesus was strong and powerful. When it came to the religious leaders, if they were misleading people spiritually, he said, man, woe to you. You're in trouble. When the disciples kind of got out of line, he loved them, but he said, man, watch out. Jesus was deeply loving, but strong. And so we read the story of Jesus. First, we discover in the center of the story, the life and the love of the Son. This is the center of God's story as he walked on earth. And we see this, that Jesus was born in obscurity. Jesus was born in humble circumstances. The King of heaven didn't come with trumpets and fanfare and with parades. This is how he came. Verse 4 of Luke chapter 2, bottom of page 6. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem in the town of David, because he belonged to the house and the line of David. And he was there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. So Mary and Joseph go for the census. Verse 6. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born. And the babies usually decide that, not you. And the time came. Jesus was going to be born. And she gave birth to her firstborn, a son, and wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger, in a feed trough for animals, because there was no guest room available for them. How did God enter human history? Boy, he could have come and just blown people's minds, but he kind of snuck in quietly. And you see, as Jesus lived his life, he spoke the truth with strength, but he wasn't putting on a show. He was revealing the presence of God. He was God the Son with us. When you read through the Gospel of Luke, you see that Jesus loved with incredible compassion. I was struck by this. In chapter 4 of the books of the Bible and Luke, and actually, if you're not sure where you are, at the bottom, it always gives you like in a light gray, it gives you the verse reference, not verse by verse. And in the original New Testament, there weren't chapters and verses. Scribes added that later to be able to find things easily. So we're actually reading it closer to the way it was originally given without the chapters and verses. But at the bottom, it gives chapters and verses of that page, which is kind of easy, helps you find your way around your books of the Bible reading. But in chapter 4, it struck me of all these different ways that Jesus shows love and compassion in this one little chapter of the gospel. This is pages 11, 12, and 13 of your books of the Bible. But I noticed 5 different ways that Jesus loved with compassion just in chapter 4. One, he drove out demons. Jesus wanted people to be spiritually free. And where they were oppressed and where they were captured by the enemy, he set them free. And he wants to do that today. He's writing the same story. He wants to set us free. He heals many. Physical restoration. Jesus cares about our bodies. He cares about our health. And I believe that he's still a God who heals and who touches lives. He delivers someone from leprosy. And leprosy, well, that's a physical healing, but leprosy was more than just a physical healing. When you had leprosy in the ancient world, you had to announce to any time you walked around people, I'm unclean, I'm unclean. They knew what that meant, leprosy. And they wouldn't touch you, they wouldn't hug you, they wouldn't come near you. They wouldn't let their shadow touch you. If you were a leper, you were excluded from the community life. And Jesus not only said, let me cleanse your body, he said, come back in to relationships. People cured of leprosy could probably have their first hug from family members and friends that they've had in years, if ever. Jesus said, I invite you back in to human community. He healed a paralyzed man, but more importantly, he forgave him of sins. And Jesus forgives of sins. Boy, the religious leaders freaked out when Jesus said, your sins are forgiven. They said, only God can do that. And Jesus goes, bingo. Yeah, that's a paraphrase. But Jesus basically says, yeah, only God can do that. Get it? God the Father, God the Son. I am God the Son. And he still forgives sins today for all who come to him and cry out to him and confess their sins and ask him to lead their life. And then also, I love this, in Luke chapter 4. All this is just in Luke chapter 4, right? Freedom from demonic oppression, healing, invited back into community, sins forgiven, all Jesus showing his love and compassion. And then his relational world, he would eat with sinners. He would eat with the wrong kind of people. Jesus loved people right where they were at. And you know what Jesus got in trouble from, the religious leaders in his day? He got in trouble when he was hanging around the wrong kind of people. He hung around people that were broken and outcast that no good religious person would even want to be seen with. And Jesus wasn't just seen with them, he sat and had a meal with them. And that's love and compassion. Luke chapter 4, just filled with this picture of the compassion and the love of Jesus Christ. And then you read through the Gospel of Luke and you see Jesus teaching. Part of Jesus' ministry, God the Son came to teach and instruct so that we could know how to live our lives as we're filled with the Holy Spirit and follow in his ways. So just in the Gospel of Luke, you have teaching like this. This will blow your mind. Chapter 6, love your enemies. A new thought then, a new thought now. Love your enemies, but that's the call of Jesus. In chapter 8, he says, take this good news you've got from me and just scatter it everywhere you go. That the story of the sower scattering everywhere in weeds and rocky soil, but just scatter, scatter, scatter the love of Jesus. That's his teaching. In chapter 10, there's a story Jesus tells that people today make reference to and they don't even know they're referring to a story of Jesus. When somebody says, oh, that person is really a good Samaritan. A lot of people don't even realize they're talking about a story of Jesus. He tells a story of this person traveling through this kind of lonely area. They get mugged, beat up, left for dead, robbed. And a couple religious people walk by, see him, cross the street, and walk right away. But a Samaritan, who at that time the Jews didn't like, despised in a lot of ways, a Samaritan comes along and cares for that person, provides for that person, and brings medical care and financial care and walks alongside of them. When you hear someone say, oh, they're being a good Samaritan, they're going back to a story of Jesus, because stories stick in our minds and they have power. But Jesus calls us to live that way. How do you pray? Luke chapter 11, Jesus says, this is how you pray. And he teaches us how to pray. In Luke chapter 15, the story of the lost sheep, the lost coin, and the lost son. And it shows the heart of a God who is searching and seeking for his children to bring them back home again. That's the heart of Jesus. Compassion, he taught and he trained. In the book of James, we're told, don't just hear the word, don't just hear the Jesus stories. Oh, that's a nice story, but do what it says. Every teaching of Jesus shapes us so we can keep living out his story. And then what seems like the end of the story comes in Luke chapter 23. This is page 51 in your reading guide. But Luke 23, 44 says this. It was now about noon. Jesus is hanging on the cross. He's dying for our sins. He's bearing our shame. It's about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. For the sun stopped shining, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. And Jesus called out in a loud voice, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. When he had said this, he breathed his last. Jesus died on the cross. He took our sin, he took our punishment, he took our shame, he took our place, and he bore our judgment, and he died. And it seems like, boy, is that it? Is that all there is to the story? But we celebrated last Sunday that Jesus rose again in glory. And after Jesus rose, he spoke to his people. And he said, prepare yourself because something's coming. Someone's coming. There's a power that's going to be unleashed in your heart and your life, the Holy Spirit of God. That God the Father is the master storyteller. Jesus is the center of the story. But the Holy Spirit is writing the story of Jesus in your life and in your heart, whether you know it or not. And if you're a Christian, you sense his leading and his power, I hope, every day. And if you're not a Christian, understand that God wants to write a story in your life and through your life that would blow you away. He wants to work in ways that would amaze and delight you. So Christ has died on the cross. He's risen again. And he's sitting with his disciples. And they realize, okay, Christ is alive. He was dead for 3 days. He's alive, and he's teaching them. And this is one of the final things that Jesus says. Luke 24, beginning in verse 45, or page 54 in the books of the Bible. Beginning in verse 45. So then Jesus opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures. He told them, this is what is written. And he's talking about himself. The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day. This has already all happened. See, that was written. It was prophesied. and repentance for forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem, from right where we are to the ends of the earth. You're going to tell the story of Jesus. You are witnesses of these things. I'm going to send you what my Father has promised. But stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high. That power from on high is the Holy Spirit. I started reading the book of Acts because that's this next week's reading. And I'm going to get a little bit ahead. So I had a little time earlier this morning. I read the first about six pages of the book of Acts from my books of the Bible. And I was struck by the Holy Spirit just all over those opening pages. It's the Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit. God says, I'm not done. I'm not even close to done with telling my story. Now, that story will be written in your life. And just like at the beginning when stories were told mouth to mouth, life to life, person to person, before there were books written, before there were TV and movie screens, people told stories with their words. Jesus says, now we're going old school. And I'm going to fill you by my Holy Spirit. I'm going to lead and guide you. I'm going to be alive in you. And you will become a story for the world to see that God is alive and Jesus is real. And there will be moments, listen closely, there will be moments when God will say, the Holy Spirit whispering in your heart, tell your story of the difference Jesus has made in your life. Tell your story and talk about Jesus. That's why we're doing training Wednesday and Sunday, because it's we don't go, how do I tell my story? Where do I start? That's all that we're going to focus on for 2 hours, how to tell your story, making your story, and in your story, people meet Jesus. Why? Because when you're a Christian, he's in your story, man. He's in your life. He lives in you by his Spirit. And this right here, if you notice this, you're thinking, man, Shoreline got a hot tub. This is great. No, Shoreline does not have a hot tub. This is for baptism. And the water's not warm, so don't think about jumping in here. It's pretty chilly, all right? But you're going to see in just a moment. We had 3 people in the first service, 2 in the third service, 1 in this service being baptized. And when you watch this person go under the water and come out of the water, understand God is writing a story. And they're standing before God's people to declare, God is in my life. The Holy Spirit's at work. God's doing something new and fresh. In the book of Romans, the Apostle Paul says in baptism, he says, we're buried with Christ in baptism. The picture is, even as Christ died and rose again, when you go into the water, the picture is, you're buried with Christ in baptism. You remember that you died to your sin and your old life, and then you're raised again to a new life. When someone comes out of the water of baptism, the picture is, they are raised again in the power of Jesus, and God's writing a story in their life. So in this time of baptism, and I invite the team to come forward and find their spots here, whoever, musicians and team that leading the baptism, but I invite you to watch this picture. And when this person comes out of the water, understand they're declaring, I now walk in the resurrection power of Jesus. God is writing a story in me. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, thank you that you're still working. That God Almighty, our Father, you wrote the story. That Jesus, you came and you are the story. You're the center of it all. But Spirit of God, you're moving now. So even right now, in this moment of baptism, may we see a next step in the story of salvation and the work of Jesus. By your Spirit, bless this moment, and may we rejoice that through Christ we are buried to sin and we've died to the old life and we have been raised again in the power of Jesus. We pray this. Amen.
Well, this is a wonderful time of celebration in Denise's life. Denise Ganji began following Jesus when she was 11 years old. She wants to be baptized because though she was baptized as an infant, she's recommitted her life to Christ, and she wants to show that it's now her own decision to follow Jesus and that she is in him and he is in her. To Denise, God is her Father and Jesus is her leader and her very best friend. So let's celebrate as Denise is baptized in the name of the Father, the name of the Son, and the name of the Holy Spirit. Woo.
Let's all stand together, sing that he's worthy of it all.
You're worthy of it all. Oh, you're worthy of it all. For from you all of me, to you are all things. You deserve the glory. You're worthy of it all. You're worthy of it all. deserve the glory.
Sing it out.
Cause you are worthy of it all.
Let's lift our voices.
You are worthy of it all. For from you are all things, and to you are all things.
Before I dismiss you, I want to give you two invitations. One, I really want to encourage you to look at this Wednesday evening or this coming Sunday, those 2 hours, and set that aside to learn to tell your story more effectively, because God's going to open the door with some person you love and care about. And it's going to be your story that God is still alive, God's still working. Your story will help them see the face of Jesus. Would you be open to that and come and get equipped and trained to do that this coming Wednesday or Sunday? And then also after the third service this morning, 1 o'clock to 2:30, I'm going to be leading a new members class. I do it about 8 to 10 weeks or so. And if you want to learn more about membership at Shoreline, just come and join me in the Pacific Room right through the hallway over here at 1 o'clock. And it's an hour and a half class. I'll share with you the vision of Shoreline, and you can see it. And if you're here short term, like military, but you want to kind of align with us for the season you're here, come to that class and learn about what it means to be a part of Shoreline Church. If you want prayer, come forward for prayer. There's people waiting that would love to pray with you. And if you're new at Shoreline, God wants to write a story in your life. It's not an accident that you're here. God is on the throne. He's brought you here today. Before you leave, go out these doors and over to the Connection Center and just tell them you're new. And they want to give you a gift. Thank you for coming. Answer any questions you have. As you go from here, go knowing that God the Father, the master storyteller, knew you before you were born. In your mother's womb, he knew your name. Psalm 139 says that every day of your life was written in his book before one of them came to be. He's watching over you. God the Father is watching over you. Know today that God the Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, left heaven and came to earth to bear your sins, to die on the cross, to rise again, because he loves you. And as you go from here, go in the power of the Holy Spirit, knowing that God is still writing his story. And you bear that story in your soul, but you also bear that story on your lips. So go walking in his story, go sharing his story, and go in his power. Amen? And read the book of Acts this week, because we're going to talk about it next week. God bless you. Have a great week.